There's a new type of video out on YouTube at the moment, and it goes along the lines, I've only had my new Defender for 4 weeks and it's already been back to the dealer 5 times, have problems fixed. And these are getting hundreds of thousands of views and have many thousands of negative comments. A real PR disaster for Land Rover. So what's going on and why is it happening? Hi, it's Bill the Engineer here. I'm filming this from my land in the Alentejo region, and I'm in the middle of the annual pruning of the olive trees, except it's a bit more like tree surgery. Bloody hard work, and you shouldn't get involved unless you're a glutton for punishment. But I digress. Today I want to look at the apparent serious early reliability problems with the new Defender and see what's going on. Now, to make it clear, I don't come from the automotive industry, never worked there. I was always in the offshore oil and gas industry, and we of course had exactly the same challenges on reliability, except that the consequences of failure could be orders of magnitude worse. So I think I've probably got a pretty good experience base and skill set to take a fresh look at this problem. To resume, well, I'm pleased to say there is a methodology available for looking at reliability problems, and it's called, would you believe it, reliability engineering. Now, this is a methodology which is about 50 years old. First tentative steps taken way back in the Second World War because of reliability problems with military equipment, but that was done on a simple test and correct basis. First meaningful attempts made to gather reliability data made in the 60s and 70s, but the real leap forward came in the 1980s, firstly with the arrival of the PC, and secondly the publication of the first textbooks in the field. This is an absolute classic work by David J. Smith, first published 1981, still in print about 40 years later, albeit now in the 9th edition. Reliability engineering has two sides to it, the quantitative and the qualitative, and I'll firstly touch on the quantitative side. And the whole methodology depends on having available screen reliability data, normally at the component level or the level of the sub-assembly. And the way it works is you postulate a sequence of events which can lead to an overall failure. And this is often depicted in the form of what's called a failure tree, and the various boxes are joined together by Boolean logic. And so, to give you an example, say in the case of a process plant, and you might have a failure of a gas detector, gives a false alarm saying release of hydrocarbons, you're going to get a local shutdown, and then by a domino effect you're going to get progressive shutdowns until the complete plant shuts down. And that is a major overall failure. And the methodology is exactly the same irrespective of what you are dealing with. I know it's going to be a successful video. I got some visitors who couldn't wait and they came for a sneak preview. Or maybe they just want to guzzle the food I very kindly provided for them. Who said there's no free lunch in this world? These guys know better. I now want to talk about the failure rate, which is the foundation of any type of reliability calculation. And this is often quoted as a single number and the most usual units of failures per million service hours. And if you work it out, a million hours is around 114 years. And looking at typical numbers for individual components, things like capacitors, you get numbers which are well below unity. And for more complicated items, things like, say, diesel generators, you get numbers up in the thousands. And this means if you're running a Jenny full-time, you're going to get several failures per year. Slightly disturbingly, I see that things like CO2 analyzers, the sort of sensor you'd have in the exhaust system of a modern vehicle, they have failure rates in the range 100 to 500 per million man-hours. And that's quite high. But there are problems with just quoting a single number. Firstly, most items have more than one mode of failure. So a simple item like, say, a valve, it can fail open, can fail closed, or it can leak to atmosphere. And each of these modes of failure have different consequences. Secondly, the failure rate isn't constant over time. Now, for a wide range of items, you find that the failure rate follows the famous bathtub curve. So you get high failure rate in early life, the so-called infant mortalities. You then drop to a more or less constant failure rate during the service life, and towards end of life, it rises again with the so-called wear-out failures. But lastly, even at any given point in time, the failure rate isn't going to be a simple number. So if, for example, you take 100 normally identical components and you test them in parallel until they all fail, they aren't all going to fail at the same moment, and they will fail over a spread of time, and probably the best you can do is to represent that as a probability distribution. It means that the simple failure tree type of calculation which I showed, where you plug in individual failure rates and by a combination of Boolean logic and simple arithmetic, you compute a failure rate for the system at the top, this doesn't apply. So what do we do? Now, if you're dealing with random quantities, the way to handle this is what's known as a simulation, or often called Monte Carlo analysis. And in this, it means that the input parameters are specified as probability distributions, and the output from the calculation, in this case the system reliability, again this comes out as a probability distribution. Now, I'm going to digress very quickly, but you'll see where I'm coming from. And if you're talking about an investment decision, be it the decision to invest in a new product, a new vehicle, or capital investment, this obviously needs a financial justification to put to the board to get approval to proceed. And for larger investments, this will be done in the form of a financial simulation. In other words, you're using exactly the same techniques, and indeed often the same software which you use the reliability analysis. Now, the output from the reliability analysis is going to have a big impact on the project economics. You know, if you've got a very unreliable vehicle which is going to give you very high warranty costs, it's going to affect the bottom line. And in practice, what tends to happen is you just morph the two models together. So the reliability analysis is one of the quantities feeding into the financial modelling for the overall project. And if you have an integrated model like this, you can play tunes on it. So you can, for example, look at the impact of increasing the quality of the components going into the vehicle. So the build cost goes up, but the warranty costs come down, and you can play tunes and optimize it. And hell, this isn't difficult. Even my own little consultancy was doing this type of work 10 years ago. Firm like Jaguar Land Rover, with many thousands of highly qualified engineers and mathematicians, I'm sure they got teams of people on it doing reliability calculations and also financial modelling. And what I'm driving at is I think they know exactly what they are doing.